Today I'm going to Peak Performance Fitness Center with one of the co-owners, Chad Dunn, and he's going to teach the preacher how to get all physical. I'm looking forward to getting all healthy and nutritious and in shape. Hey, I'm here at Peak Performance Fitness Center with Chad Dunn, and he's gonna teach the preacher how to be like a fitness guru or a personal trainer or super fit, I'm sure.
So at Peak Performance, we own your fitness facility. So we have your gym. We also have yoga classes. We've got boot camp classes. We've got personal trainer sessions, one-on-one, group training, sports-specific training, and we also offer nutritionist and registered dietitian on site.
All right, and then what time for the gun show?
Oh, it'll be after. Get your tickets.
All right.
Use the power push. Come and just push it straight down towards the wall. Take off running and walking.
Piece of rope, basically, just move it up and down. Get your heart rate up. So simple as that. All right, so next thing you're going to do is your push-ups.
Push-ups. Oh, I got this one. You don't even have to show me. I know how to do a push-up.
Show me what you got.
So toes together, hands about shoulder width apart, and...
No, Kevin, that's not it. All right, Kevin, so now that I've shown you a few exercises for, like I said, what you do during your class, do you think you're ready to give your first class a try?
Well, with Chad's excellent teaching and guidance, I think I've got this. I really got this. Okay, so maybe my workout didn't turn out quite exactly that glorious or glamorous, but hey, this is my story. I'm sticking to it. And here's how the rest of the story maybe really went.
They said it would be a piece of cake. That was no piece of cake. I need a piece of cake.
How do you think I did, Chad?
Kevin, you made excellent. Like I said, you had a great class. You showed what to do. I mean, I'm proud of the accomplishment you've done today, so I want to see you back here again.
Do you think I look better, that I, you know, that I am a little more buff now?
I can't recognize you anymore.
Oh, very good. Well, today I learned about physical fitness, nutrition, and proper form, really. And I want to thank Chad Dunn for his expert help and the whole team there at Peak Performance Fitness Center. And I may actually end up back there again. They're going to a full 24-hour, 7 days a week, kind of a format that you can just, with your slider card, sneak in there late at night. So I'm looking forward to maybe even sneaking in myself. It was a good time. Thanks, Peak Performance. This was unforgettable once again. Throughout the gospel, John writes this eyewitness account of a Savior who comes as God in the form of a man to reconcile the world to himself. He comes to make a way. He comes to make the way for us to be in a right relationship with God. You know, speaking of fitness and that kind of thing, some people would say that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. In fact, the Bible says that our bodies are the temple. Here's the unforgettable and the interesting part for me is why on earth God would want to dwell in this body. And depending on how you view yourself, you might also wonder, well, really, would God want to, wouldn't he sooner just be beside me rather than be in me? And if you really struggle with your self-esteem, you might say he wouldn't want to be anywhere near me. He'd want to run from me. And yet, regardless of how we feel about it, God feels quite differently. God made you. He loves you. The Bible's quite clear. We're the work of his hands. And he's got this desire to move out of the tabernacle, out of the temple, and into his dwelling place. He's got this desire to live in you and live out through you. After the feeding of the 5,000 that we did last week, out of this overflow and this abundance and all these blessings that we see, Jesus continues to teach, and the religious leaders of the day grow increasingly bothered by his unconventional ways. You know, when I slapped the fish last week over the pile of bread, some people were a little grossed out and turned off by that. Let me be sure to tell you that the rabbi, that Jesus, that the teacher did much more confusing and confounding things, that the religious leaders of the day found it hard to explain, found it hard to understand. He kept causing a stir. He kept causing problems for the religious people, and they began to plot against him. And we pick up in John chapter 7 how Jesus went around in Galilee after this that had just happened, the feeding of the 5,000, the teaching. And he goes on to teach about communion and teach about eating of his flesh and drinking his blood. And I mean, it's way too much. And he who sent me, he was making it increasingly clear that he wasn't just a good teacher, that he was God incarnate. And as he began to clarify that for the religious people of the day, they began to have a problem with him. They began to plot against him. He did not want to go about in Judea where everybody could see him, because the Jewish leaders there were looking for a way to kill him. And he knew that his time had not yet come. But when the Jewish festival of tabernacles was near, Jesus' brothers said to him, "Leave Galilee and go to Judea, so that your disciples there may see the things that you're doing. Why don't you go to this festival of tabernacles?" Now, normally when I'm reading through Scripture and I come across Passover or the festival of tabernacles or one of these Jewish feasts, I skip over it. I don't pay much attention to it. I think, well, what's that got to do with anything? That's something that the Jewish people did or do, or I don't know, but it doesn't have much to do with me. And one of the things that really I was unable to get beyond was verse 2 this week when I was reading through Scripture, and I thought, what is this festival of tabernacles? Have you ever wondered what these feasts and festivals that are touched on in the New Testament, why on earth they're there? If this really matters at all, why it's there? Jesus goes ahead and he tells his brothers, my time is not yet here. However, after his brothers leave, he decides that I wasn't going to go, or certainly not out in public. In fact, the Bible says that Jesus decides to go in secret. After his brothers leave for the festival, he decides, I'm going to go along, but not publicly, but in secret, Scripture says. There's seven different Jewish festivals, most of which I've never cared about. I'm just telling you the truth. I know I would have learned about this stuff in Bible school, but at the time it was like, I will memorize it and put it down on a test, but I do not care. Sorry, confession's good for the soul. But all of a sudden, I started to think, like, what if it does matter? What if this festival of tabernacles matters? Every one of these festivals and feasts are also known as appointed times, convocations. And they were given to the Jewish people to have three different parts to them. Israel, the Jewish people, were to observe this holiday in the present, like Passover, right? They were to do this thing. And then they were to remember in this present observation something that had happened in the past while looking forward to some future prophetic purpose hidden within each festival. So I got to thinking, what if this Feast of the Tabernacles has something hidden in it for me? What if this Feast of Tabernacles that the Jewish people were to observe, to remember something in the past, what if there's something hidden there for us? So when we're cruising through the book of John, and we get to chapter 7, and we look at the Festival of Tabernacles, it really is pretty easy to breeze by that festival and miss the significance. But beginning in the spring, these Jewish festivals hold something we ought not to miss. The Passover was really just redemption from sin and this foreshadowing of the one-for-all sacrifice that Jesus made. But then we read of this Feast of Unleavened Bread, 7 days of bread without any yeast. Now, I thought this is something that they would agree with at peak performance, right? Don't be eating all that bread, right? You probably can't tell from this angle that you're looking at me, but I love my bread. I've got nothing against carbs, but during these 7 days, for some reason, God had foreordained that for 7 days they would not eat of bread with yeast. Yeast causes things to rise. It causes things to move. And this was a foreshadowing of the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes into believers today, he empowers us to leave our old lives behind. The Jewish people were being reminded at how long it took for them to get ready to leave, for their exodus from Egypt. Anyhow, the first fruits, the festival of first fruits, that remembers and acknowledged that God had delivered them from Egypt and had given them this promised land that you've heard of. And it was to remind us, it was a foreshadowing of Christ's resurrection as he was the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Oftentimes, people don't realize that Jesus was a first fruits offering, just like I referred to at offering time a little bit, that we are to give our first portion. This Feast of Weeks is another one of these. It's number 4 on the list, and it's also known as Pentecost, is what you'd often hear of it as. And the primary focus of this festival was gratitude of God for the harvest. And this feast foreshadows the fulfillment of Jesus' promise to send another helper along. The Feast of Trumpets sounds like a loud time, huh? Good times, signifying the end of one season and the coming of another to the Jewish people, but a foreshadowing. Throughout Scripture, we see that trumpets are used to foreshadow the second coming of Christ. And then this Day of Atonement, the sixth feast that we see mentioned from time to time in the Bible, with all the descriptions and all the detailed instructions given in the book of Leviticus of how the Jewish people, not us, we're under no obligation to observe these, but we get the benefit of the foreshadowing. We get the benefit of being able to see some of what's yet to come and some of what we should know about. And this Feast of Atonement, or actually Day of Atonement, just 10 days after the Feast of Trumpets, was the day the high priest went into the Holy of Holies, the tabernacle, each year to make an offering for the sins of Israel. And today, we know that it is Jesus Christ who goes into the very throne room of God as our high priest. And he makes atonement for our sins. And really, there's some foreshadowing there of the great tribulation, which I don't dare even touch on today. But then we get to number 7, this Feast of Tabernacles. The seventh and final feast takes place 5 days after this Day of Atonement. And it's this feast here that Jesus said, I better just lay low. I'm not going to be wandering around Galilee. I'm not going to be wandering around Judea. I want to just lay low here and keep a low profile. I know that my time has not yet come, and yet I know that they're trying to plot against me. For 7 days in this Feast of Tabernacle, the Israelites, the Jewish people, would present offerings to the Lord, during which time they would live in these little huts or tabernacles, dwelling places. And they still do this today. Out on their balconies during this time, they'll have flimsy little structures built that for 7 days they'll eat their meals in these places. Some of the most devout would even sleep in these. They'd be living in these booths, really. And it reminded them of their temporary dwellings that their forefathers had to live in during their 40 years on the way to the promised land. See, they were presently observing this holiday, the Feast of Tabernacles, remembering what God had done for them in the past, how he provided for them when they were living in these temporary dwellings, these tents. But hidden within this festival is a foreshadow of the future time, when Christ not only would rule and reign, but even for a time when the rest of eternity, people from every tribe, tongue, and nation. See, this was the only Jewish festival that everyone was invited to. That it wasn't just for the Jewish people. That the Gentiles could come as well. And that all the nations could tabernacle or could dwell with Christ someday. This foreshadowing that we could dwell with Christ in the new Jerusalem. See, when Jesus was talking about this Feast of the Tabernacles, it was a foreshadowing of a time when we could invite Jesus into our lives, to not just sit beside us, but to be within us. By the power of his Holy Spirit to dwell within us, even when we feel like he probably wants to run far from us, we know that he wants to live and dwell
within us. John chapter 7, we pick up the story here at verse 11. And now at the festival, the Jewish leaders, they were watching for Jesus. They were expecting him, and they were asking, like, where is he? Is he not coming? This is our opportunity to seize him. We want to get him. He's been teaching a lot of troublesome things. Among the crowds, there was widespread whispering about him. Some said he was a good man. Leave him alone. He's performing miracles. He's loving on people. Don't give him a hard time. And others replied, no, he's deceiving the people. But no one would say anything publicly about him. I mean, they were fearful of what people would say, what the religious leaders would say. How about you? Do you ever find yourself, when the conversation turns to God, maybe even the God who dwells within you, who you've invited to come into the very center of your life? Are there times that when the conversation turns to God, you just freeze? That you don't dare say anything publicly? And I say, thank you, Jesus, that some of you aren't saying anything publicly. Because Jesus shouldn't be something we fight about. It shouldn't be something we condemn and judge people on. But there'd be no problem with talking about the real Jesus. God of love and acceptance and forgiveness. People would welcome that Jesus like the people did then. Now, the religious leaders didn't, but the people did. Verse 14 of John chapter 7, we read that not until halfway through the festival did Jesus kind of emerge from the crowd, go up to the temple courts, the outer public part, just outside the inner part, but out in the public area. And he began to teach, and a crowd would have began to gather around him. And the Jews there, I mean, they were amazed at what he was saying. And they would ask, how did this man get such learning? He didn't sit under the Pharisees. He didn't sit under the other religious leaders. And Jesus answered, my teaching is not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. You can imagine how the religious leaders felt about him claiming about who it was that sent him. And as that clarity of who he really was began to emerge, they thought all the more about seizing him. But no one laid a hand on him. John 7:37, on the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and he said in a loud voice, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. I mean, can you imagine how unforgettable this would have been? The first time somebody outside the temple courts or outside the temple, right in the courts, in the public area, stands up and in a loud voice says, hey, if you're thirsty, come to me and drink. The blasphemy that they would have felt in that situation. He goes on to say, whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, well, rivers of living water will flow from within them, within them. Unforgettably, people are left asking, who is this guy? And really, that's the question we're left with. Some in this passage say he was demon-possessed. Some would say that he's a good teacher. The Bible says that many believed that day. And that they believed that he was God incarnate, God in the flesh, that he was the living God. And 2,000 years later, after many Bible burnings and and all sorts of intellectual people have denounced the Bible. Millions and millions of people still gather to learn and to worship. And the question comes down to a personal, internal dwelling one. Who do you say that Jesus is? See, unforgettably, a perfect God, a God of love and acceptance and forgiveness, looks at our judgment, our condemnation, our sin, our separation from His perfection. And He says, just as you are. Just as you are. I want to have a relationship with you. And we've got this incredible opportunity to say, God, not my way, but yours. Would you forgive me for going through this life my way? I mean, Dr. Phil says, how's that working for you? Right? And if you look around most people's lives that have it all together, that will denounce this book, that will tell you all sorts of things that, man, I can't believe you're doing this, I can't believe you're doing that, their lives are a stinking mess. How's that working for them? We've got this opportunity to say to the living God, this isn't working. Forgive me for going my way. I want to invite you into the tabernacle, the temple, the dwelling place. God, I want to invite you into a relationship with me. God, I submit to you. Would you pray with me right now? Just as we bow our heads, Lord Jesus, right where we're sitting, God, not just me praying, but each of us bowed before you praying, God, in our hearts and in our spirits, in our minds. We come to you and we say, Lord Jesus, fill us up. Dwell within us. May we not just attend church or observe church. May we not just be on a spiritual journey toward you, but God, this day, would you come in? Would you fill us up? Would you turn us around and help us to head in the right direction in this life? God, we want to honor you, and we want to open our hearts up, our souls up, for you to be in us, dwelling here. Jesus' name. Amen.